Dr. Lachlan Farrow and Dr. Rob Schreiber, thank you for coming to talk with me today. Between you and individually, you have decades of experience caring for people with serious illness, and many of them are elderly. Now, many of us, before we become seriously ill or elderly ourselves, had the experience of caring for a parent or other loved one who is experiencing that. And that brings up a lot of challenges and questions. My own father is 90 years old. He has some serious health issues and he's not doing so well. And of course I want him to have the best care possible, but I'm realizing that I don't really know what that means given his age and his health issues. So can you help me figure out how to approach that with him and his doctor and how I should start thinking about it? Dr. Schreiber.
Yes. Well, first, thanks for the opportunity of having this discussion because I think it's really important. Something that we all need to reflect on, and I think this is an opportunity to really talk about an issue that impacts us all. The issue that you're facing with your dad is one that I think many of us face, and I face personally. And when we talk about somebody who's not doing well, who's older, who has serious illness, it's really important to understand what is their goal, what do they want. Many times they understand that things are not going well. They have fears. And when you ask people how they're doing, they can be very upfront and they'll tell you that they know they're not doing well. And when you ask them what do they think's happening or, you know, how many good years do they think they have left, it's pretty interesting. They can be very frank and honest and, you know, you'll be surprised that maybe I have one or two good years. And I wouldn't be surprised if you asked your dad that. That's what he would say. The question then comes down to what's best care possible. Best care is really dependent on what he wants and what he's trying to achieve. What's important to his life? What makes him happy? What makes him sad? How does he want to live? How does he not want to live? Those are the types of issues that if you don't have a discussion with, it's very hard to determine what best care is.
Yeah. And what I would just say is most basic thing is, just as Dr. Sharp saying, this is about your dad as a person, as a human being. We get all worried, even we as doctors, about the medical things, but honestly, any medical thing, whether it's medications or doctor's visits or surgery or whatever it is, they're just tools. And they make sense or they don't make sense if they're really helping the person have the best life that they can have. So we sometimes like leap into thinking about, oh, would my dad want this kind of thing or that kind of thing or that kind of thing medically? Stop and sort of back up. Your dad is a human being. He's 90. I'll often say, if I was talking to him, we think of you as being in chapter 90 of the book of your life, and we're trying to figure out in whatever time's ahead, you know, how can I as your doctor help you? Most important thing is you as a person, as you're looking ahead, what do you most hope for in whatever pages or chapters there might be? What do you hope for? What would make those as good as possible? And then if I can get some sense of that, then I'll add a second question, which is not as much fun, but it's just as important. When you look ahead at whatever pages or chapters there might be, what do you worry about? What do you maybe never want to go through? Because we need to make sure that all the medical things make sense for you as a person. They get you the most possible of all the things you hope for. And anything you worry about, you never want to go through, we need to make sure either that's never going to happen or we have a plan if it ever does. But it's got to start and end with your dad as a person, as a human being.
I mean, I've heard a lot of stories from people whose parents and loved ones, you know, died in the hospital, they were in pain, they weren't really fully conscious. It's not really how they wanted their illness to go, even recognizing themselves that they were seriously ill. I don't think it worked out the way that they would have wanted.
But one of the facts, and like we're Americans don't like to talk about this, that everybody knows is true for every single one of us is we're mortal. But Americans don't like to talk about that. And then if we've never talked about, like with your dad, about what's important to him between now and the end, but this really isn't primarily about dying. It's about between now and that future time, how can your life be as good as it's possible to be? And then a part of that is, and if we ever got to, if it looked like we're in the last pages, you know, the last part, Does your dad have thoughts about what he would want that to be? Some people don't. They just want it to be as far in the future as possible. But there are other people who, what they've really thought about is, if my time ever comes, I don't want to be in a hospital on machines. I want to be home. I want to be comfortable. I want family around. Well, unless we plan for that, at least in the United States, if there's some problem, someone's going to call 911, you're going to be in the hospital. It's not going to be that way.
Okay.
But having said that, some people are the opposite. They're not thinking about being peaceful, quiet at home. They want to go down fighting. If they can eke out any extra time, they'll put up with all kinds of things.
There's actually three things that you bring up. One is longevity. How long do people want to live? How do they want to live? The quality of life. And then how much pain and suffering do they want to go through? And so when you talk about a situation where your dad may be ending towards, you know, getting on and have limited number of years left because he has advanced illness, what's more important at that point? The other thing is that was brought up, and when you have somebody who's ill, what is the expectation when you go into the hospital? How likely are you to have a recovery, and what does recovery mean? Does recovery mean that you're going to end up alive but living in the nursing home the rest of your life? Is that an acceptable recovery if you decide to go for a treatment or surgery? Or is it likely that you're going to end up suffering for several months and maybe dying, which is very common in the older population at the end of life? We spend 50% of the healthcare dollar for Medicare in the United States in the last year of life. And it's not the type of life that Lachlan's bringing up in terms of what we want to try to achieve for, you know, your dad. So having those discussions of really understanding what is likely to happen, how they want to live, you know, what a good life is about, then when we get to the point where the options are one, where longevity is not going to be there, where they're probably going to suffer and they're not going to have quality, we can then talk about how do you want to live those remaining days of your life? What's important to you? What do you want to do? Who do you want to connect with? Who's important to see? What is the type of messages and experiences you want to leave to those you care about?
And one of the things, and it's just striking, but it's human. Every one of us knows we're mortal. Every one of us knows everyone we care about is mortal. That fact is the yes. only thing in healthcare, maybe the only thing in life that we all know with 100% certainty is going to come up, right? Number one, all of us, it affects all of us. Yep. Number two, we really, really care how it goes. When it goes badly, you know, the last part of my mom or my dad's or a loved one's life, when it goes badly, it's not just bad for the patient, for that person. Everyone who cared about that person, loved that person for the rest of their life is either angry or scarred or guilty or when it goes badly. But when it goes well, and we're talking about the last pages, right? There's time before that. When it goes well, people are sad when they've lost someone they care about. But over and over, when they have the right kind of support, they look back and yes, it was sad, but that was some of the most meaningful time our family ever had. Right? So it's really, really important to get this right in human terms. But there's no chance of that if we don't, all of us, get better at talking about it. And I can promise you, not 100%, I can promise you, your dad has thought about these things. Now, I'm a guy, I can say maybe a guy, he may not want to talk about it to other people. I can promise you he's thought about these things. So the question is, and actually worries about these things. So the question is, and it may be you, the best person, it may not be you. It may be helping make sure that, you know, he's got the right kind of doctor who has real skill in getting your dad to talk about these things. But unless your dad has said things to people, nobody can know how to really make the time ahead the way he would want.
So I'm realizing that we need to have those conversations. I'm not entirely confident that I know how to do that. Is there somewhere I can go that will sort of teach me how to do this or give me some some prompts, give me some advice on how I can raise this, both with him
I think most important, still relatively new resources is an initiative called the Conversation Project. Conversation Project was catalyzed by Ellen Goodman, a longtime Boston Globe Pulitzer Prize winning columnist, because she one day, when she was an active columnist working on Deadline, gets a call from the nursing facility where her mom was with advanced dementia. And they say, "Oh, are you Ellen? Are you the daughter?" "Yes." And said, "We think your mom may have pneumonia. Do you want us to start antibiotics?" And Ellen says, "Well, I'm on Deadline. Can I call you in an hour or so?" And they say, "No, no, we need to know now." Mm-hmm. And then Ellen said, "Like, what are you asking me?" Mm-hmm. You know, she hadn't thought about that. She said, "You know, back before the dementia, I thought my mom and I had talked about all of this, because my mom had said, 'Oh, if I'm ever like that, pull the plug.'" Mm-hmm. But there was no plug. We actually hadn't talked about this in any way that was helpful. So Ellen, talking to other people and finding almost everyone she knew had some similar experience, said, "We need to find a way to talk about this," and started this organization, wonderful organization called the Conversation Project, which with lots of work with patients and families now has something called the Conversation Starter Kit. So you can go to the website, conversationproject.org, download the Conversation Starter Kit. My family has used this. I mean, I'm supposed to be an expert about this, but there's just something really nice about a user-friendly, concrete thing to look through, write down, jot down answers, and talk. So that's one resource that I think anybody watching this and people they know would find very helpful.
Just to add to what was stated, they have actual videos of people having that conversation and how to start the conversation. So one thing you could do is say, "Dad, you know, I decided to go on because knowing that you're, you know, struggling, you know, I'm hoping to be like you one day, but I would want to understand what my options are." And so I became aware. You could even say, "Hey, I did this taping and I learned about this, website where we can have a conversation so I can understand what's important to you. And I'd like to sit with you and go through this with you." And so doing it together oftentimes opens up that door so that it's a starter. Doesn't mean you have to go through the whole thing. But I think, you know, before even doing that, you may just want to have a conversation with Dad and say, "Dad, you know, just tell me, you know, how are you really doing? What are you worried about? I think we brought that up before. What's important to you?"
I'm also interested in this idea of the healthcare proxy. Can you explain more about what that means and how it works and how that could help my father get what he wants?
So it's important that everybody have a healthcare proxy, and not just older people, but anybody over the age of 18. Anybody who is a legal adult by definition needs, at least in Massachusetts, to have a healthcare proxy.
And what is a healthcare proxy for people who may not?
And so what that is a document where you basically appoint someone to be your decision maker along healthcare matters in the event that you are unable or incapacitated to make decisions for yourself regarding healthcare decisions. And so without that, without appointing someone over 18, if there is disagreement in your family, then there could be strife and you may not have somebody, one, that's speaking for you. You could have different voices and be put in a situation where you're having things done to you and for you that may not be what you want.
Right.
And so as a result, it can become, you know, very, very challenging. So it's really important that people not only appoint somebody who can do this substitute judgment legally. And by the way, you don't need to see an attorney. There's forms you can download from, you know, the web if in Massachusetts and get it signed. So that's your official form. But it's also important to have that discussion about, okay, in the situation, if I was seriously ill, the types of treatments, you know, you would or would not want to have. Now, normally, most people our age or younger or even older, you know, who are in good health would probably want to have everything done, you know, full treatment. But Your dad, who's at the end of his life, relatively speaking, you know, in the 90th chapter, you know, that's a different situation. Mm. They may not want, and usually do not want, everything done. They've lived a full life. They want to make those remaining days, months, years meaningful and one that is filled with quality and joy, not pain and suffering.
So it needs to be available, you know, when it's needed, which means his doctor should have a copy. If you're the person who's his healthcare proxy, then you should have a copy. But sometimes the best person to be someone's healthcare proxy is actually not the closest family member. It can be a friend or somebody, mm-hmm. sometimes even someone with a little bit more emotional distance, because some people say, like, I know my wife or my daughter could never do X, Y, or Z, say X, Y, or Z, and I don't want her to worry about that. But you need to have somebody who is prepared to be your voice if you can't speak for yourself, or else you may not be taken care of the way you want. People who've lost someone, being able to look back and say, you know, I miss him, but he was taken care of the way he would have wanted, and the last part of his life was as much the way he would have hoped as it possibly could have been. Those are amazing, priceless things to be able to say. Mm. And that's the payoff of having these conversations. Mm.
Right? I had a patient by the name of Betty who was on dialysis and had finally decided no more. She had been suffering, struggling, and her daughter and her son were really couldn't accept it. But she had made the decision, we supported it, and she ended up going to a nursing home to basically die. Those last 7 days were the best days of her life in the last 8 years of her life. To the point, she got to see everybody. People from all over the country came to visit her. She was literally the queen on a throne. There was a sign-in book. There were parties. She had lobster. She, all the things she wanted to do, she did not have pain. Mm-hmm. She was off of pain medicines. And then when she finally died after 8 days, she died within 12 hours, but having done everything she wanted, to the point that the daughter, who was struggling with this decision, became a volunteer for hospice services.
Wow.
And continues to work in that capacity. Real life story about what happens when people's wishes and goals are met. No.
You talk to people who work in hospice, and they have countless stories that are variations like that. But just even worth, there's people hear the word hospice and go, oh, no, that not now. No, I'm not going to die. My mom's not going to die. The biggest mistake people think about hospice, like, because they hear that word, is, oh, that's where you go to die, which is not at all what any hospice nurse I know thinks she does.
So tell us, what is hospice care, and how is that different from this other term I hear, palliative care? Yeah,
so hospice is care through the end of life. The philosophy is for people who've said, I'm now focusing on each day, one day at a time, making it as good as it can be. I'm not going to sacrifice today or tomorrow for medical treatments, chemotherapy, other things that may make me sicker this week, but maybe there's a payoff down the road. You know, I'm moving into one day, one week at a time, make it as good as it can be. The hospice people understand they're taking care of people through the end. So, of course, it includes caring for someone who's dying. But that's not what they think they focus. That's not what they focus on. They focus on living.
Right.
As fully as possible in this last phase.
Right.
And they have countless stories of reconciling family members, somebody's joined hospice, it's a difficult adjustment initially for some family members, going, oh my God, mom, no, you need to have more chemotherapy, whatever. But the hospice people have enormous skill in helping people really understand this is what mom wants. And then the kicker, more and more studies are now starting to show, is that people who enter hospice early, not just the last couple of days of life, live often at least as long, and sometimes longer, than the people who are going ambulance back and forth to the hospital. When you stop to think when you stop to think of it, when somebody is frail or seriously ill, 911, ambulance, emergency departments, you know how stressful that is on someone? Mm. And when someone has the support at home and their days are as good as they can be, their will to live is stronger, like, then I want to say, well, like, of course they're going to live at least as long that way. One of the other common mistakes, and even doctors often ask this, is asking your dad, so what's important to you, length of life or quality of life? Right? People say that, and there's a way in which it makes sense. There is a way in which it makes sense. But honestly, they usually are not alternatives. They usually go together. If somebody is having good quality of life, they want more. If somebody's quality of life is lousy, they don't care about having more. If somebody's quality of life is good, they tend to live longer, right? So this isn't, oh, I'm choosing quality of life, but that means I have to die sooner. Yep. It actually doesn't work that way. If anything, it's probably the opposite.
So you mentioned palliative care, and it sounds like it's not the same thing as hospice care. Yeah,
so. Correct.
How does that work?
So it is and it isn't. Hospice care is actually, or palliative care is hospice care, but it's palliative care at the end of life. But palliative care also involves people who are going through pain and suffering from surgery that are going to have a full recovery, or people who have chronic illness who are declining, where their goal is to minimize their pain and suffering and live their best possible life. It's palliative care is a discipline. It's actually a medical specialty. But in fact, internists, geriatricians such as myself, and surgeons, we all do palliative care with the goal of trying to improve people's quality of life, but at the same time, giving them the best outcome possible. So if you look at a spectrum from well to end of life, palliative care encompasses the entire spectrum of care, but hospice care is really palliative care at the end of life, where the goal is your quality and comfort.
Okay, thank you. Now, I also got some advice that my father should fill out a MOLST form. What does that mean? Is that different from
that? So the MOLST form, and MOLST is one of these god-awful acronyms, M-O-L-S-T, Medical Orders for Life-Sustaining Treatment. Right? It's basically just a form, a piece of paper that is standardized across Massachusetts, having learned from other states where this was so helpful, that is recognized by anyone. EMTs, 911 comes to your house, and they don't know your dad, not sure like what he would want. This MOLST form very clearly says he would or wouldn't want X or Y specific things, and people will follow it anywhere. So it's a very helpful form. If there's an emergency, you're not there to explain, the EMTs arrive. But honestly, the point is, can't be the form, because what's on that form is only good guidance or not if it, getting back to where we started the whole conversation, if it really fits your dad as a person and helps make sure he's being taken care of the way he would want. So people sometimes say, oh, we just got to fill out the MOLST form. If you have not had the conversation about with a patient about what's important to them, what do they hope for, what do they worry about, want to avoid, and then the MOLST form can be a way of helping with that. But if you haven't had that other conversation, I'm not sure I'd find the MOLST form particularly helpful.
It's also important that the MOLST form be used at the appropriate time. It really is meant for people who have advanced illness, who are going to be wanting only certain types of treatments after having that conversation. For younger people, we don't normally do a MOLST form. We have the healthcare proxy, but we have the conversation because most people would want most things done. The MOLST form really is to focus on those people who have limited life expectancy or have very clear directives because of an illness that they have of things that they would not want to have or would want to have.
Yeah. The default is going to be somebody comes in an emergency. We do everything possible to keep you alive. That's the default. We err on the side of life. We're not sure. The MOLST form can make it clear if somebody's older or frail or seriously ill. But some people use the MOLST form to make sure they're getting every possible thing because they may have advanced cancer or other things, but their first great-grandchild is going to be born in 2 months. They would give anything for that. And they don't want somebody saying, oh, this poor person with advanced cancer. So their MOLST form may be the way to say, do every possible thing to keep me alive because they want to see their first great-grandson.
Right. Right. Yep. That makes sense. So this conversation that my siblings and I obviously need to have with our dad, what is the best time for us to broach this with him?
Honestly, I often say it's always too early until it's too late. So you need to think about the earliest, soonest time to try to bring it up. And there are lots of different hooks that you can have. The Mass Medical Society years ago started a program that we've used at Beth Israel Deaconess now for almost 20 years around Thanksgiving holidays, because humor can help, and it's talk turkey days, time to talk turkey. And we actually jokingly, but seriously, pass out over 1,000 healthcare proxy forms to everyone and actually say, blame us, the people at the hospital, Dad, I was at the hospital and they were saying, like, have you talked to your family about this? And I realized I hadn't. Just some excuse to bring it up. And then a second thing is, this can feel like a burden. Oh my God, what a difficult, heavy conversation. I mean, it can feel like that, but honestly, it's a gift from your dad to you to be able to have his daughter know in case you're ever on the spot. It's a gift from you to your dad so that he knows he'll be taken care of the way he would want. And the people who've had these conversations, they often say, you know, it was like so hard to get started. It's like this big speed bump. It's hard to get started. But all of a sudden, I was like talking to my dad about like the meaning of life kinds of things that I haven't done since I was like 7 or 10 years old.
Right.
We talked about things that weren't just about the medical things. So it's hard to get started, but I would say the first, soonest opportunity you can think, try.
When you're all together.
Okay.
I mean, it's really when you're all together. And then anniversaries, Thanksgiving, Turkey Day, I love, that we use the same scenario. But, Thanksgiving's quite a while away, so you may not be able to have that conversation. So don't wait, but have everybody together. And, it's interesting, again, having those conversations. I had a son who was serving in the military and was going to Okinawa and was going to be going to active duty. We had to have that discussion. So 2 days before he was leaving, we sat down over breakfast and we had the talk about what happens.
Another hook, and again, it's blending humor, but is every year starting April 16th, used to be National Healthcare Decisions Day. Now it starts April 16th. National Healthcare Decisions Week, have these conversations. Why April 16th? Because April 15th is tax day, and death and taxes are the two inevitable things. And so the idea is, okay, yesterday you did the taxes, but there is one other thing that's inevitable. Time for that one too.
One more thing I wanted to bring up. I have a friend who is going through this with her mother, who is 85. She's a person of color. She has always been nervous about trusting the medical profession for historical reasons, I think. And that seems to be another challenge that her family is facing. It is harder for her mother.
This is a great topic, and we could do a whole other show. We'd be happy to do sometime about the real reasons, the good reasons why people who are marginalized in any way, and it can be African American, it can be lower socioeconomic, it can be other ways, and don't trust our health system, have both special challenges in this area, but maybe even more importantly, to talk with them and help them understand and make sure the health system knows this is what they want and it's respected. There's a wonderful statewide organization, just a few years old, called the Massachusetts Coalition for Serious Illness Care. Very simple, one-line goal: make sure everyone in Massachusetts is always taken care of the way they would want. Right? That's what we've been talking about. Massachusetts Coalition for Serious Illness Care. They did a survey last year of people across Massachusetts asking about the quality of the care of a loved one in the last part of life. And it was hauntingly worrisome results. People saying how often the care was not excellent or good, how often their loved ones' wishes were not respected, and much, much worse quality of care, much, much worse how often their loved ones' wishes were not respected for non-white, lower socioeconomic, just exactly these populations. Right. And so it is even more important, if it's possible, to make sure that people in those communities themselves, and there are churches in inner city Boston that are taking leadership roles in this, have these conversations, and they're in charge.
Right.
So having advocates that are able to ensure that the individual's needs and wishes are understood, their cultural mores and the belief systems are appreciated is really critical. So if people have faith leaders or other types of civic leaders, trying to connect with those faith-based organizations to educate the caregivers, to ensure that somebody's voice is being heard, is really critical.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lachlan Burrow and Dr. Rob Schreiber, for coming to talk with us.
Lucy, thank you so much for this.
Thank you. It was an honor today, Lucy.